Thank you for your interest in the API and UX design patterns, I would say. So I believe a lot of people at some point when they use Vue.js, they have a necessity or requirement to integrate with APIs, and usually it ends up being an Axios call or a Vue.http call in Vue.x action. And then once they start going, you become christened in this regard, because it gets bloated quite fast and it becomes hard to maintain over time. So I just want to talk about the Vue.x and the design patterns case for the REST API and Vue.x. So the first question everyone asks is how people use it, and how can you implement your own business requirements and finish your ticket at the end of the day. So first naive approach, when you go over the Vue documents, you stumble upon the Vue lifecycle methods, which are used to either spin up some promise jobs or some other calls which might be bootstrapping an application or reaching out the endpoint. And here I put just Axios because it became quite popular and everyone is just a thing to go with Axios if you don't want to have any headaches. And people often place integration points into created hook and then call the web server, get the response, and then set some spin inside of the component. Yes, it is loading, and then once the promise is fulfilled, then you set the loading to false, and then update the local state, component state, and here you have some component logic which is bound to an API. So the second one is routing guards. So if you use VRouter, you can define callbacks or hooks to route events or router events. And as to this example, I define before route enter. You can fetch your data and then call the next once your data is prepared and fetched from the server, and the VM is Vue instance. So you just assign the global state here to some server response, but it has a lot of drawbacks. Handling global state is considered an anti-pattern, and at the same time it might be good for fast prototyping and getting their MVP. But once you establish your MVP and something is working, it is becoming unsatisfactory on the long run, because you don't know what to expect from this code at any moment when your service or API will fail. So if you, for example, don't have any processing logic for the API errors or network errors, this will just kill your end user's experience, because your applications will just die in widescreen and here we go. So nothing to show, users will complain, and bug tickets and bug reports will come as HR tickets, travel tickets. So the component lifecycle hooks and routing guards are not the best option to
always.
Super awesome.
You always do.
It's just, we can open these guys there. That helps already. We can.
Support you.
darkness. Yes.
That helps, right?
So, with both of these approaches, there's nothing wrong, but as I said, you start experiencing maintenance overhead over time, and you start relying on multiple sources of truth, which is not good to manage big mid-sized to big applications, where you have to rely on one single source of truth to make guarantees for your end users that the data will have consistent shape and users will see the same things. And with this basic approaches, you cannot give 100% guarantees, because you don't know at what point your API might fail, and at what point you will reach the scalability issues with these with this kind of approaches. So the third design approach people use is fetching components, which are components with just a render function defined, and they operate on scoped slots, and they know how to inject the responses and render the different loading states for your data while your API is busy making selections and making JSON results. So here is the template of the component called fetch data, and it fetches the repositories from GitHub, and it shows the loading indication message, and then there's a default scope slot which has properties called response, and response is being passed down once the AJAX promise is fulfilled. You will see slope scope contents rendered, but it is up to you. It might be any component inside of it, so it depends on.
Sorry, is that a library?
No, it is indeed.
The other screen.
Yeah. Okay. It is a showcase by Adam Watton. I don't remember, but somewhere people were discussing the patterns where people can use container level components to encapsulate the API calls. So container level components will have to know about the lower level implementation details of the child scope, which is not so good. You know, like the abstraction shouldn't depend on concrete in concrete implementations, and this is going against open source principles. So but as you can see, I don't know how to simulate this. Yeah, you see the loading. I will do it again. Loading repository is first displayed from the beginning, and once a promise is established and it is fulfilled, it just assigns properties and sets the required data. So this loading shown first, and then as you see, over the render function just returns different scopes or scoped components or scoped sections. So this was one of the hacks. I consider it as a hack, because it is really not so elegant, is to my opinion. And here is my presentation. Okay. And here's the source code. I stripped off some things, so once the fetch data component is about to get into a DOM tree, the created method is called, and then here they hook up into AJAX call, which just resolves the acquired data once server returns some response, and then it just renders slots based on this flag. If it is loaded, then render the list of repositories, otherwise render the loading section or loading indicators. So this is how people try to do it also. And my talk about Vuex and how to integrate Vuex with REST API calls and how to make them more nicer. But it is still far from perfect. Yeah, as you can have impression already, if you have developed Vuex applications, like Vuex store actions and mutations, all sorts of state management features, then you'll notice your actions become the place to make an API calls. So the API calls live inside of the actions, and then you have to manage some error handling and response handling, and then handing over the updated state from the server down the tree or the commit to the store, so it gets updated to local state, and finally it gets rendered in the web page. So here you can see only two examples, but just to my experience, your action files, store action files, become huge over time if you don't care about the project structure and domain separation for your Vuex actions or for your store implementation. So you end up having hundreds of lines. Someone's have thousands of lines. I worked with some guys, so they had problems with Vuex actions in one firewall for one specific domain of managing user profile, and floated up to 1,000 lines with processing errors for different states, and this was horrible. So
these people do.
And then the time comes for the organizing this mess into something which is more consumable by larger audiences, and people naturally want to work with the things that they like, and not people tend to avoid chaotic and messy things, but it happens that people often can't avoid. So one of the solutions that I'm using actively is the design pattern called repository pattern, which is a way to organize your business logic and then your implementation logic, and have somewhere in between the domain layer which interfaces between the two. So interface logic or implementation logic just knows how to call your mediator with some default parameters. So the responsibilities on this point for your components is over. Your component should not know anything about your backend or your domain logic. So components should be clean, in my opinion. So, and repository pattern is often used in Java world when you try to organize a data access layer to a database or some external service. It is a sure thing to go just establish a repository pattern with different domains inside of it. Domains might be user domain and profile domain or authentication domain. So each domain contains its own business logic, and it should be a small piece of logic which is not leaking outside of its domain, but it provides a nice way to interact with the rest of the system. So This reminds me about microservices, because microservices try to develop clear boundaries where a microservice owns its own data, but it doesn't depend on other services, and it can be deployed and can be changed, can be dynamic on its own way, and the other parts of your whole ecosystem is not dependent on your particular implementation. It is just single piece of code which just provides some interface which is known by other parties, and other parties know how to use it, and that's it. You don't need to know the low level implementation details for how to call service B, how to call service C in order to get the piece of data you want. So on this, the reason why I started to explore organizational patterns for the API and VX is that once I came in Berlin, you have to register, go to Auslandsbehörde or Burgamt, and the day when I had to go to Auslandsbehörde, instead of Auslandsbehörde, I went to Immigrants Processing Center and spent 2/3 of the day there watching their desktop applications and dictating over and over and over again, from one room to another room, one person to another person, and at the end of the day it was like, hey, you are not in the right place, you have to go to Auslandsbehörde. So, and then a week later I started to just port the desktop applications I saw, it was just a rough idea how they work, and I started to sketch my idea how do I want to port the applications into web. So I started a Vue.js application and then passed through all of these stages, and yeah, how it usually repository contracts work in Java. They are implemented via interfaces, and interface can define a standard set of methods: create, read, update, delete, or patch, or some other weird methods. But these are the usual things that in Java applications people do. They define an interface and they just implement interface, or they define interface, make an abstraction on it. So abstract class implements some parts of the interface and then passes down the responsibility to the lower tier components. So this was the idea that I wanted to have, because I have experience as an Android developer, and having Java experience also calls you to create abstractions around some problems that you can solve easily with abstractions rather than without them. So the goal was to define the VX actions which only know about how to call and what kind of arguments they need to pass to the repository, to the API module, or whatever you call it, and then their responsibility ends on it, and they only know how to maintain the following state upon the response from the repository part. So this is the current state that I have. So I have a domain for managing users, and I have an action called load user with current user ID. Yeah, it is user ID. Okay. And it just knows how to call the load user function, just passing the user ID and nothing else. So, and then it knows what to expect. So, on these two things, the responsibility of this action is over. So the next steps is, in my project, how do they look? Is like this. Because in front-end development, it is established that people call it store, and store and repository is kind of similar thing, so I just decided to name my repositories an API module, which contains a different different domains, which are basically bound to API endpoints. So in this case, when I call a user user to load, it just calls the load user, load users. I copied the wrong one. With the user ID, it loads it, and in the middle, it just adds some intermediate response checking, and if the response is successful, or if the response is internal server error, or some not found or not valid codes, so they do pretty much the same thing as everyone does, but in more hidden way. So you on your domain layer, your repository functions just operate with the endpoints, and the domain level knows how what resource to call, and what kind of checks and what kind of methods to use to inquire the demanded data. So, and here I have a demo time. Let me check. I just spin up my. I can't see my mouse.
Meetup page that he's coming in. It makes sense. I said, of course, come over and so on. And now since Spotify doesn't see ready in front of the door. I'm not sure how long he waited, but he's not there anymore. Yeah, I didn't see the message.
Yeah, so that's not my project again. This is the very first page, which is just a login page, and here you have a default state. And default state is usually empty state for all of the applications. And once okay, so you start seeing the UX actions, which effectively bootstrap the whole application. And what is my window? So from the base state, everything takes an inception. So once your application is ready, and you have authentication details, and your session is in place and it is valid, I just dispatch the bootstrapping action. So it loads all necessary data to actually render the application. And here I don't use server-side rendering because it is not supposed to be for public usage. It is more like a personal information management system. So for people who are eligible for government benefits or social benefits, mm-hmm. like people in need who actually need some social goods, and as everything here is a REST API call, and if you go for the network, you can see all the actions which are going on there, and how to return to. So clean up, and then how to clean up. Okay. You see, I also handed over the management of interface states to Vuex, and I have generated a big chunk of test data, so it is loading up, and here you can see some data which is being rendered and requested from the server, and everything is bound in this way. Like I said in my presentation, the current layout of the project for the API is this. I can even show you in code. No, it is the old one. I'll show you the new one. So recently I migrated over to Vue CLI 3.0, and I always wanted to drop the config and list directories, so my dream came true, so I can use final presets and don't care about Webpack 90% of my time. And so this is the API part, the repository which I use. And this is the domain-specific logic, which is aware of how to construct the request, and then return back the results of the request. And as you can see, it is not crowded, and you don't see one domain the repository action a huge line. So processing the response and preparing the response. It is encapsulated on different levels, and I also tried to avoid Vuex modules as long as possible, because Vuex modules force you to think again in terms of design patterns and architecture. So I didn't want to force myself to diving and reading into additional exploratory part. How to organize Vuex modules, and I wanted to keep away some, but nevertheless I tried to organize them as much close as possible to Vuex modules. So I just defined the separate folders and then separate mutations, separate actions inside of the potential module. And so here in the user actions, don't care for it. Don't mind it. So as you can see here, a Vuex action knows how to finally fix it. One moment. Vuex action actions only know how to what kind of payload they accept and what kind of more correctly speaking, what domain-specific function to call. So, since my repository returns the promise, I can just take over from this point and then add up additional checks or make some currying or make some unwrapping of the response and then just setting the state. So, this is it on my Vuex actions part. So this is the I don't know, in Vue.js community, people more tend to use camel case action names, and as I have like some years of React experience and Redux experience, you can see some weird duck here. This is a Redux actions and action naming styles or defining styles. So, but this is not more than that. So your actions end up being clean and easier to maintain, so you have less headache and less mental overhead, and instead of managing and really diving into how to process the error inside of this section, and if not found error happens, how do I process here? So you end up waiting as if the response status is 4-4, then do this, and then set state error this, and then say status for this, and somewhere have some overlay component which just saves or notification component. Some API error happens, server is unreachable, can you try later? And, yeah, this is the thing that I didn't want, because for this thing I also wanted to use a new feature called error boundaries. I forgot how to call it in Vue.js, but in React it's error boundaries, right? And in error boundaries you can just define a component which wraps your critical component which might be prone to errors, and then as a fallback it just displays your prepared error message in order to make a pleasant user experience, end user experience, and not developer experience. And so maybe you've been asking what kind of methods I use: check, response, get, and remove. So my first iteration was based on Axios, so I moved everything to Axios, but then I dived into discussion about browser fetch and how in the years to come it is going to be de facto. So I just laid off Axios integration part for the most of it, and then returned to it at some point. So, but I tried to limit the Axios with just the helpers. So, so I just created some basic set of maybe it is better to call this small boilerplate for small HTTP boilerplates to work with APIs, and this. It is just custom tailored, and it is below 200 lines, and it has the definition of valid statuses, the basic headers which I want to use to integrate with my API, with my REST API, and then some helper methods which construct the whole response, and then just feed the Axios aliases, Axios methods. So the check response is, I don't remember, but I also said, I was in some discussion in some React community about how to maintain the dynamic components which are actually tied to your REST API, and how can you make sure that your errors, they are not propagated, but they are distributed to the parties of interest. So people were doing just creating a new error, and then attaching a new property to this response, and then actually copying the reference in the response of the API or of the promise result to the error. So promise reject is returned at the end, so you can catch it, and then if necessary just access the response from the server, and if you have some messages or custom error message or error statuses or error JSON, so you can do it like this. And I don't know, I'm okay with it, but not quite like it. Yeah. And in my case, I have an integration with Django, because it allows you to prototype fast, and Django REST framework is a default REST framework, and it creates a custom layout for the API errors, so I have to process it, and then somehow to make it eatable or consumable by my Vue.js application, so this is just a helper function for you. Then I just went to shorthanding of some commonly used functions, so instead of using some other libraries, I just went for some easy solutions that are obvious. And then these are the main functions which are being called here. As you can see, post, and then get, and put, and remove, because the delete is a keyword in JavaScript. I didn't want to call it this, or shadow the global name, and I just defined the remove method. So these functions just wrap the axios and return the result of it. So in the future, if I want to switch to fetch, I just change this to fetch style and I have it. So, and here the interesting part is just building the headers and passing the cookies and sessions to your API if it isn't on subdomain or some other domain which requires cross-origin resource sharing. So you have to do this and get has one extension just to construct the query parameters. And for upload, I just decided to rely on browser fetch because it is native on most of the latest browsers, and you just pass the form data and you're okay. If you don't need to cancel your upload request, and I don't need to do it, otherwise I use it with Axios. So. And the function is endpoint is I just decided to define a function for which you have resource location, so it just wraps and then glues it with the API server URI, so you get a fully constructed URL. But I could also go with Axios config, which defines the configurations for the API, but I didn't want to go because I want to really go to switch, but fetch makes a lot more problems than it solves at the moment, but I don't care for it. Yeah, and on the route level, I don't know, I have only the authentication part, which happens before each route enters. I just check if the session token is valid, then process next. Otherwise, if it is not valid, then clean up the browser session and redirect to the login page. But I also started to have problems when I have an API test and I tried to simulate some load tests and it started to hit my backend. There's a lot of requests, a verifying session, and between the route transitions in Vue.js, I didn't want to verify, so I added two functions which check if the browser was loaded or browser just loaded. So if the browser was loaded then, or browser or someone jumped in from the link from the email or somewhere, then I just dispatch the single entry point action which just loads up every required piece of data and then processes to next. So and then simple checks like, please, is it a login page or not login page, and if the if it is interesting for you, the browser will load. It is you can find it Mozilla Developer Network documentation. It is just a state of a navigator object using which you can just identify if the browser was refreshed or it was just fresh opening of the link. So these are two constants. Type navigate is someone just opened or someone just typed in and then opened. It happens with this identifier of zero. And And then, of course, you have to check for the support of the browser. So otherwise, you will not get it, and you have to follow it. Always loading the state. Yeah, and after demo, yeah, I've been thinking about improving this because, as I said, I started diving into UX modules and error boundaries appeared on the horizon of Vue.js. So I've been evaluating of defining container components inside of the error boundaries, which know how to and what kind of errors show for each context. So if the user is searching for other users, and if some not found user not found or access denied or some other backend errors happen, I wanted to show per domain specific tailored error messages or error overlays. So I'm just evaluating this. So in the error boundary components, you just define the error captured function, and you have the error and then a view instance and then information about the error. And then you just need to override the render function. So inside of the render, it might be your component instead of pre-tag, you might define your own component, or you might just render some dialog component from other library. So you will have some nice user journey if something fails in the backend, and it fails a lot usually. So this is but I'm still in the process of evaluating and making research for it. So maybe if people next time will want, I will try to present the results of it. So then for the network helpers, I just published a GIST, so you can see the implementation of the wrappers around Axios and HTTP stack, server interaction part, which I wrote. They are pretty simple, and they are below 200 lines, and it is pretty much okay for me. Instead of adding npm library, you just have something more manageable. And during my research and during my journey, I had a lot of insights, a lot of discussions, but these are the main links that I've been just reading into. So you can find these things here. And yeah, I also have my own blog. And how to escape. And yeah, in this blog I just wrapped everything that I told you today in a nicer way. So the meat comes at the end. So at the end, what you want are clean actions in UX and easy to maintain integration with your API servers. So, but I don't know, if you have interest, you can read through it and you can find it. Also, I uploaded a project in GitHub, and you can find it here. So in the API module is a domain for handling repository pattern. And yeah, I just put some really simple stuff, and then the store level things you can find in visual places. So actions, they're pretty much straightforward. So in the actions you have something simple, and in the helpers I also uploaded the helpers that I showed you just now. So